Let it go. Let it go with this topic specifically. Let me, as we said, that the topic is analog circuit sizing in submicron technology. So not only in micron technology, we are inside submicron technology, and there is a special kind of formulation which is called geometric programming formulation. So we'll try to understand all these jargons. I think submicron you know, and when you say sizing, what we do is that how do we decide the values of widths and lengths of MOS transistor in analog circuit. So when you say circuit sizing, it's basically the design step of analog circuit in MOS technology. Okay. In a MOS transistor, if you see the IV characteristic, that is function of widths, lengths, and threshold voltage and other parameter. But to the designer, what you'll be having in hand is widths and lengths, not the threshold, not the transconductance parameter and channel length modulation. Okay. So while you have been given a technology, what you have to do is you have to find what will be the widths and lengths of a transistor and of course the circuit topology. So what we'll start with, we'll see that why particularly CMOS and op-amp kind of circuits, and then importance of sizing automation, particularly analog sizing automation. Then we'll try to go a little bit deeper into some topic called geometric programming formulation, and what it is and what is its specialty and advantages, particularly in our context, we'll try to see there. And then we'll go with simple running example of particularly differential kind of amplifier, and we'll go step by step. And then we'll try to formulate the sizing problem as a geometric programming problem, and then final algorithms and our recent work, how we push this algorithm into the submicron technology, namely the how it goes to the technology scaling, like once you go from micron technology towards the submicron technology. So why CMOS op-amps? So what I was talking about before we start here, realization of a system on a chip, what it needs is that integrating the digital and analog counterpart within the same die. Okay. So while the code processing it is done in digital domain, analog circuit it needs for interface, maybe some of the special sorry. So this analog ports, and as I said, that it needs the interface facing things. While CMOS technology is it is a preferred technology for digital portion, namely for power dissipation point of view and logic operation point of view, analog portion it is not having any other option, but it has to be implemented in the same technology. Otherwise, you cannot make both the modules sitting in the same die and getting fabricated together. And why specifically op-amp is it is one of the key building block of analog circuits. So we focus on op-amp, and we'll try to see how much it can be extended for analog circuit in other topics maybe. But in this lecture module, we'll be talking about how to do the op-amp sizing. And why do go for the automation? Okay. So there are two reasons. I think everybody will accept this fact that once the number of transistors are more, you have to basically handle a very complex task, and on the other side, you have to reduce the design cycle. Okay. So though the analog portion in the whole system, it takes a very small fraction of the entire portion, the analog portion, it is the bottleneck for reducing the design cycle. the well-structured digital blocks, which you can basically partition in from a bigger problem into a smaller problem hierarchically, that can be designed automatically using automation tools. Of course, there is a big research going on, but I must say that all those designs in today's VLSI context, it is most of the time automation tools are used. It is not handcrafted, which is difficult for analog portion. That is mainly because circuit performance of analog circuit is sensitive. Whatever the things you have seen in analog electronics lab, you might have seen that even some little portion is going here and there with four or five transistors and circuit elements, you have seen that you are not getting this signal. So now you can imagine that if you have to integrate maybe 20 or more transistors together to perform analog operation, how difficult it will be to really design that. And on top of that, you are designing it and then you are giving for fabrication and you are ensuring that fabricated circuit should be working. It is not that on the breadboard you will be tuning and making it working. Okay, so you have to give a guarantee with some yield. Basically, the robustness of the design is also important. For digital circuit robustness, of course, it is important, but if the circuit is not really robust, most of the time the performance may be less. Like instead of running at say 1 gigahertz, it may be running at 200 megahertz, still it is functional. For analog circuit, if it is not so, your amplifier will be behaving like an oscillator. So obviously you don't want that, right? So we understand the sensitivity of the circuit performance in analog circuit, and that makes the analog circuit design still not getting handled by automation tools, and it is a research topic. So what you do in circuit sizing is basically for a given analog circuit and desired performance, our aim is to size the transistors. Maybe if the circuit is given, circuit topology is given, then you have to do the sizing. If the topology is not given or if you have multiple choice, then you have to select among given topologies. So the basic task is to size different transistors so that all the devices should sit in appropriate region of operation, namely saturation region of operation. So now you can correlate whatever you have studied in analog electronics that transistor should be in saturation region. We'll come back to that point why it will be in saturation some extent, but let it progress. What are the different approaches in this area, particularly in analog circuit sizing? So when I myself started my research work, then we have seen that a lot of people were doing a knowledge-based approach. Like if you are, say, experimenting with a circuit, you will be gathering some circuit knowledge. And then you can try to encode those knowledge through some script and then let your script do the sizing and designing of the analog circuit. However, the main disadvantage of that, for every new topology, it needs that whatever the heuristics or the circuit tricks, it has to be manually generated and it should be encoded. Otherwise, it is not possible. So it looks interesting steps, but it is surely not possible to handle a bigger system. And because of the problems, complexity of the problem, this is not getting popular, mainly because you can handle only with a transistor with maybe 5 or maximum 10 transistor, but beyond that it will be a problem. Sometimes with a new circuit, even it may be difficult. So the person who is inventing a circuit, he will be having most of the knowledge, but the other people who will be knowing its circuit operation, they may not be having full idea, and really converting into design automation, it will be even further difficult. Then there is another classical approach called optimization-based approach. So basically, we have to meet some performance criteria, and then maybe we want to optimize maybe yield or size of the circuits and whatever it is. So we can translate that sizing problem into this typical optimization problem. Like optimize a function subject to so and so functions are less than or greater than some value. So this constraints, it will come from maybe a given specification, or it may come from keeping transistor in saturation. Whatever it is, you have to meet this kind of constraints, and then on top of that you like to optimize. It may be minimize or maximize or whatever it is over a design space called X, which may be having n number of variables, and these variables are basically size of the transistors, width and length. So this, all this x1, x2 and xn, they are basically the size of different transistors. So here I am assuming that the topology is given, and hence the number of variables are also given, and our task is to meet the desired gain, desired bandwidth, and so, and maybe on top of that we make the circuit as small as possible. So we refer this f0 as objective function, and this gi's will be calling as constraint function. Source of this constraint function, it may be coming from the performance requirement, or it may be to keep the transistor in saturation region. Okay, so then in the optimization base, there are three techniques. One is equation based approach, like you can have circuit equation, which will help you to predict the circuit performance. So you can have an optimizer, which will be interacting with say this set of equation, which will be providing the circuit performance, and then along with that you will be having some optimizer. That optimizer may be deterministic optimizer, or it may be genetic algorithms, or it may be some other heuristic based algorithms. But broadly speaking, there will be some equation based, and then there is another technique called simulation based. So instead of using say analytical equation, what you can have is a simulator like SPICE or Spectre, which will be predicting your circuit performance for a given set of values of width and length. So if you are having say say this approach particularly, obviously for each run you have to get the circuit simulation, and it may take some time. Even it may take say maybe within a minute or even whatever it is, but if you are say iteratively optimizing the things, and if the iteration is more than 1000, now you can imagine that how much time it will take. So that is the time aspect. So the disadvantage is that it takes long time for optimization, particularly this simulation based, and this one equation based, inaccuracy of those approximated equation might lead to the inaccuracy in the final design, and also it needs expert designers hand into this one to develop those equation, and most importantly they are not global optimum. So there is no, I should not say they are not global optimum, but there is no guarantee whether it will be a global optimum. So if you are designing something, it may be working fine, but maybe your friends might be designing better than that. And still, I don't know, maybe I can claim that I can do better than that. So still there is no guarantee of global minimum. So then we started this approach, something called geometric programming. And these are the two approaches, basically same approaches, independently started. I myself started with my guide, and then from Stanford also, independently they have tried the same approaches. And the end of that, what you're getting is that sizing problem, it is getting mapped into geometric programming problem. Okay, and after this one, the direction of that research is going to this direction. So let's see what is geometric programming. So we'll not be going further from what are the present developments are happening here, but let's try to see what is geometric programming problem and why we go for that. First of all, it is very fast. Okay, and there is a guarantee that it will be having a global optima. So if you follow this approach, whatever the design solution you will get, there is a guarantee that it is the best. Of course, if you give some circuit and if you give very strict constraint, and then of course it will fail. And since it is having the property of finding global minima, it will fail. And that also it will say that even if you are having an expert designer, he will also not be able to make the circuit working to meet that spec. So if say this approach is failing, that indicates that is the limitation of the circuit itself. It is not the design steps involved into that. Okay. So and also what it is doing is that we are trying to incorporate the two different technology, but for all these things you have to give a guarantee that the objective function, which is F naught and constant function, they should be polynomial. So this is another jargon apart from geometric programming problem. So let's try to see what is this jargon, polynomial. It is not polynomial, it is polynomial. So this geometric programming problem, it is same as this optimization problem, except this is polynomial, all these things are polynomial. Okay. So let's see what is geometric programming problem. So it is optimization problem. This objective functions and constant functions, they are polynomial in this domain. So what is this speciality of the polynomial, and what is its typical property we like to explore in our design steps involved. So this is the polynomial functions form. It will be summation of different terms like this one. Each of the terms will be having positive constant, non-negative constant, multiplied by variable power constant. And this alpha, whatever, ij, they are any real number. It may be plus or it may be minus. And each of these terms we are calling monomial or product of power terms. So we can say that polynomial will be having number of monomial terms or POP terms. Okay. And of course, this variables, another constant is that all these variables should be non-negative, preferably positive. So all these variables, we know width and length of the transistor, of course they should be non-negative, otherwise it is meaningless, right? And suppose since all of them are non-negative, and suppose one term is there, if it is the non-zero, that means positive, some term is there, the corresponding term, let's consider this one, it will be always positive. That is because all these variables are positive, their powers, whether it is positive or negative, as long as they are real, this is also positive. So if you multiply with positive number, they will always be positive. And hence, this polynomial function, it is always positive. Okay, so this is first property of the polynomial function. Shall we move on? So let's see what is the property of polynomial and what is the property of product of power terms. So let's consider only one term, and let's take first derivative with respect to say one variable, say x1. So we got this first derivative, and then we took the second derivative. Now what we are getting is that it will be expressed in terms of whatever the variable we have taken here. The corresponding power is say alpha I1. So this alpha I1 multiplied by alpha I1 minus 1 divided by x1 square into the same POP it will be coming here. Because after this two derivatives, what we are doing is that we are reducing the power of this one. So if you divide by x1 square, that x1 square it will be coming here. And with this x1 square along with whatever is left behind, they will be forming basically here, and they will be forming the same original POP. So I should say that second derivative, it is this real number multiplied by real number minus 1 divided by x1 square multiplied by POP. So we know this is positive, and these two can be any real number. Now depending on their value, either they may be positive or negative. So if say this entire thing or the second derivative is positive, the corresponding POP, it is convex along that particular direction, along that variable. If it is negative, then it will be concave. So pictorially, what we are saying is that this kind of function is convex. Mathematically, how do you define is that you take any point, and then if you join these two points, this line segment, it will be always above the original function. If it is always true, if it is meeting that condition for any arbitrary two points, then we will be calling this function is convex function. If it is other way, if this line segment it is below this function, then it will be calling it is concave. That means if you are having a tumbler which is upside down, it looks like a concave. So convex and concave. Okay, what is the property of that convex? So if you are having say some convex function like this one, and if you say that this is convex throughout, then suppose this is the value of x at which this function is minimum, then you can say that this minima, it is minima over this zone. And if this function is convex throughout, then you can say that the locally whatever the minima we are saying here, that is also global minima. What does it mean is that suppose if you have a local minima, and if you give a guarantee that this is a global minima, and if you find this local minima, then you can give a guarantee that yes, this is the final design point, which is optimal design point. So that is the property we are trying to extract, that we like to prove that this polynomial function is basically it is a convex function. Okay. So anyway, if you directly deal with the POP terms like this one, and based on the value of alpha, either it may be positive or negative, and based on that, it may be convex or concave. So there is no guarantee of convexity in arbitrary direction. So this is along x1 direction. For x1, it may be convex. For x2, it may be concave. Then in along arbitrary direction, it may not be. There is no guarantee whether it will be convex or concave. However, if you take log transformation, and let's consider y is the log transform domain instead of x, and this is the relationship between x domain and y domain. And then if you deal with the same product of power terms or monomial terms in y domain instead of x domain, what you will get is that it will be in this form. Now if you take the second derivative of this POP, what you will get is the real number squared multiplied by POP. Now POP is positive, and this is, you know, it is a real number. Whether it is positive or negative, it is raised to the power 2. So then entire thing it will be positive. Okay. And I should say strictly it is positive. Therefore, we can say that this POP, it is convex in y domain. It is not convex in x domain, but it is convex in y domain. And hence, and it is convex in all y direction. So even if you give any arbitrary direction in combination of the two axes, you will be getting the convex function. And that is true for the polynomial function. Okay, that is the key of this design approach, basically showing all the objective function, constant function as polynomial. And since they are convex function in log domain, then we can say that optimization problem, it is a convex optimization problem. The property of the convex optimization problem is that if you find a local minima which is optimal in particular point, that is also a global minima. So if you say that I am having some optimizer which is solving my problem locally, and it is showing that it is optimal design point, then we can say that that is also a global minima. Okay. This is to make you people awake and interesting. If you consider, say, this kind of function, which is say x squared y power 0.5. So x is in this direction, and y is in this direction, and the function is in this direction, which is z. So you can see that this one along this direction, it is convex. Right. So if you take any point from here to here, and if you draw some line segment, that function it will be always above that surface. However, if you look into say this direction, particularly if you see here, which is visible here, the function, it is bending like this one. That means it is concave. So along this x direction, it is convex, and along this y direction, it is concave. So along this arbitrary direction, it is very difficult to conclude whether it is convex or concave. However, if you go into log domain, so function is same. So instead of dealing with x and y, we consider this log. So we scale basically x and y in log scale here, and the same function, it is getting mapped into this one. We can see that this stiffness of this convex, it is getting increased here, and not only that, the function here which was concave, that is also getting converted into convex. Is it okay? So that is the property of this polynomial. So what you do is that instead of dealing with x domain, let we convert our design optimization problem into y domain, which will be convex optimization problem. Then we solve this convex optimization problem in y domain, which will be giving a guaranteed global minima, and then we'll be converting back into x domain. So while we are playing with say W and L, instead of considering linear scale of W and L, let me consider log scale of W and L. As simple as that. Like you may remember that in Bode plot, the function may be difficult to get any shape, but once you translate into log scale, you have seen that you can asymptotically map into straight line, right? And so it is same thing here. Instead of dealing with W and L, you increase the W and L or change the W and L in log scale rather than in linear scale, as you have done for collecting the Bode plot data. You are taking the frequency point uniformly placed in log scale. So similar thing you can do here. Okay, so that is the key of it. Okay, so let's look into the circuit sizing. I think so far we are talking about a little bit abstract and mathematical things, but I am sure that you will be able to correlate whatever the things we have studied in analog electronics. We know in most transistors, its simplistic model is like this one, and particularly if it is in saturation, if I consider NMOS enhancement mode device, if it is in saturation, its drain current, it can be expressed by this form, and it will be having two parameters here, which are function of the technology. Designers is not having any control on this one. He will be having control only on widths and lengths. And of course, the VGS of the transistor, based on the biasing and all, VGS may be different. And also, we are having 1 plus lambda VDS term. So basically, what we can say is that drain to source current is a good function of widths and lengths, and also the overdrive voltage of the transistor, which is same as VGS minus VTH. Okay. So let us start with this kind of simple model. But you have to remember that this simple model, it is fine for maybe micron technology, preferably more than 2 micron technology. But if you go into submicron technology, this model, they are not accurate. So we'll see that how we can deal that part in submicron technology later. So if you look into say this equation, you can rearrange this equation in terms of VGS. So VGS will be threshold voltage, and then another term which will be function of VDS, W and L, and this you can approximate as a constant. Similarly, instead of dealing with VGS, you can also deal with VGS minus VTH, and we normally call it is effective gate to source voltage, VGS minus VTH. It is function of width, length and currents. Now you can see, we can get a look into this one. If I consider this is constant, and if they are variable, then we can say that overdrive voltage is function of width, length and current in the form of POP, monomial function. So this function, it may not be convex always, but if you go in log domain, if you deal with log scale WL and I, then their relationship is convex. Okay, That is what we are trying to explore. And we know this part, like we are keeping the transistor in the saturation region, and this portion is linear region. So at the beginning, there is no guarantee whether the device, it will be in saturation region or linear region. But then if you put a constraint, like if VDS is higher than some value, which is VGS minus VTH, then we can see the device is in this region. So to get this simplistic model, what you do is we extrapolate this characteristic in this linear region also, and then we put a constraint so that there will be a guarantee that actually the device is sitting here. Okay, so we are not really dealing with this linear region, we are dealing with only the saturation region, maybe extended version of the saturation region, but then we are putting separate constraint to ensure that all the devices are beyond this dotted line, namely it is in saturation. Okay, now to keep the device away from the subthreshold region, once again we are putting a little constraint, like we are saying that overdrive voltage should be more than maybe few hundred millivolts. And if you look into, say, this constraint, it can be rearranged in this form, and we know that this VGS, it is in a polynomial form, so some constant divided by polynomial, it is polynomial, so this is, I should say, monomial. Then this constant is basically, it is a monomial. It is a special kind of polynomial constant, but basically it is a monomial constraint. And also, as I said, that to keep ensure the device is in saturation region, we like to put additional design constraint. This is not coming from the specification, but we are putting this design constraint so that device will be here. So we are putting an inequality constraint on drain voltage and gate voltage, and ensuring the device in saturation. And we'll be showing with the running example that this is also getting translated into polynomial constraint. Similar condition, it can be generated for PMOS also. So for simplicity, we are concentrating only on NMOS, but surely you trust me that we have done that for PMOS as well. So that's about the DC operating point and things like that. If you look into the small signal parameter, which is a transconductance parameter, the detailed derivations are here. But end of that, what we will get is that GM is 2 times IDS divided by overdrive voltage. So this is POP. So this is variable divided by POP. So this is also entire thing is a POP. Similarly, drain conductance, GD, this is also in the form of POP. So we are calling this as some constant, and then once again, this is one variable, this is another variable. So GD is also POP. Okay, so at least we understand that all this GM, GD, and ID, or say overdrive voltage, they are POP. So let's look into this circuit and try to utilize that information. And let's try to see what are the things we do here to keep the device in saturation and things like that. So you may recall, this is differential to single-ended amplifier, right? Can you recall from your analog electronics? So this is the output and this two are input. So to keep all the devices in saturation, what you have to do is that if you appropriately apply a common mode voltage at its input here and here, let's consider this is common mode voltage. We like to give a guarantee that all the devices are in saturation. Anyway, this PMOS, it is diode connected. So if all are balanced, this is surely it is in saturation region, and hence this is also in saturation region. But then we have to give a guarantee that these two devices should be in saturation region, and also this device in saturation region. If this one is not in saturation, what we'll get is common mode gain will be high, right? So the common mode rejection ratio will be bad. If these two are not in saturation region, differential mode gain, it will be low, right? So we have to give guarantee of these two devices as well as this one in saturation region. So from balance equation, we can say that these two voltages are same, provided these two voltages are same, and also these two are matched pair, these two are matched pair, then these two, V3 and V4, will be same. Now, if that is the case, then whatever the currents are flowing here, we can say if it is a mirror, based on the mirroring ratio, what we will get is this current, it is basically flowing through this one, and half of that current is flowing through this branch and through this branch. So current flow through all these devices, it can be expressed in terms of this bias current and maybe the sizing ratio, and of course a factor of 2 or 0.5 for this branch and this branch. Okay. So VGS, now we can always say that threshold voltage plus the effective gate to source voltage. Now this portion is POP, okay, and so we can say that effective gate to source voltage, it can be expressed in terms of POP. So basically for all these devices, gate to source voltage, it is summation of threshold voltage plus a term called POP, which will be of course function of widths and lengths of different transistors. Now if you try to put some constraint, like to keep say this device in saturation, like its drain voltage should be higher than gate voltage minus threshold voltage, what you will get is that a constraint like this. So effective gate to source voltage of transistor 1 plus effective gate to source voltage of transistor 6 should be less than whatever the common mode voltage you are applying, plus threshold voltage of this one minus threshold voltage of transistor 6 and minus threshold voltage of transistor 1. So if I consider this entire portion is given, that means if they are constant and if this is given, and if these two are POP, what you can say that this constraint is a polynomial constraint. So that is the summary of this story. To keep this device, you will be getting a constant which is a polynomial constraint. Okay, so that's what you are telling, that each of these terms are basically POP. So similar derivation you can do for M1 and M2. So I will not be going in detail, but end of this one what you will get is a POP constraint. Right? And then on top of that, if you want to meet say a common mode range, negative common mode range and positive common mode range need to be satisfied, you will get another constant like this one and another constant like this one. So end of that, what you are getting basically the polynomial constraint. Now if you look into say AC constraint, so far we are dealing with DC constraint and keeping devices are in saturation. Now if you look into say AC specification, like small signal gain and common mode rejection ratio or common mode gain, and then we have to deal with the transconductance GMGD. So we have shown that GMGD all are POP form. Now if you look into say low frequency differential mode gain, what you will be getting is GM of this transistor or this transistor divided by GD of this transistor plus GD of this one. Okay. Now if you are having a requirement something like this one, gain should be higher than some given value, then you will be having this inequality to meet a gain specification. You can translate this constraint as this form. Now GM, GD, they are POP. Now this entire thing, it is coming like a polynomial. So this polynomial, once again you are having a polynomial constraint to meet the differential mode gain, right? So similarly for common mode gain, you are getting this constraint. So you trust me that if you are designing this circuit in your hand calculation or the iteration, I'm sure that it will be taking at least 3 to 4 hours to you to play with the circuit, even this kind of simple circuit. But if you say use this kind of equation, I'm sure that within half an hour you'll be doing it. And on top of that, if you encode all this equation in a program, it will be a matter of 1 minute job. So that is the strength of this approach. So what we are saying is that the sizing problem of analog circuit, it is getting converted into geometric programming problem. And we know that all this constraint optimization problem is basically convex optimization problem in log domain, and hence there is a guarantee of global minima. Okay. So this is the overall design methodology we propose to follow. Say if you have a given topology and say specification, do the optimization formulation, basically geometric programming formulation, and then you solve this problem. While you are solving, you need the technology parameter like K value, threshold value, and other things. So we call device model parameter should be supplied here. And to solve this one, you may require some solver, either a geometric programming solver, or you can use any kind of constraint optimization solver. And end of that, you will get the value of W's and L's. And most probably, you have to just verify by running a simulator like SPICE to ensure that whatever the W's and L's you got, actually it is giving the meeting the performance. So in this flow, as we said, that whatever the device we started with, that is level one model. Now we are coming into the problem. We started with level one model, and in submicron technology, there is no guarantee that the accuracy. So, and the inaccuracy might go even 100% also. Okay, I mean plus 100%. Minus 100% means it will go negative. So I'm not referring to that. So basically what we are trying to do is that if you have a circuit performance equation like gain kind of things, we are expressing in terms of GM, GD. Okay, these are topology dependent, and so the circuit performance function is function of device performance parameter GM, GD, and ID, and capacitor, and so on. So, and then we are expressing all these things in terms of transistor size, and this is of course technology dependent. Depending on the value of threshold and transconductance parameter like K, the dependency of GM and GD, and with this one, it will be different. So we are trying to split the dependency of the circuit performance into two parts. One is topology dependent part and the technology dependent part. And this portion, it is we can obtain by separate kind of device modeling. So far, this portion, it is very simple. Level one model we are using, but what we are saying is that there is a lot of inaccuracy in submicron technology, so that model is not a suitable one for this case, and we will be going to propose different kind of model. I'll just flash through all these things, but the basic criteria here, what it is that GM, GD, and ID, and the capacitor, this should be function of W's and L's in monomial form. It may not be the power be 2 or 0.5 or for that matter minus 0.5. You can have 0.112 or whatever it is, or whatever the fraction you can think of. So depending on the technologies and progress, you may have the different power. Instead of 2 VGS minus VTH square, you can have different value. But then, as long as we are giving that all these dependencies are monomial or product of power form, then all this GP formulation holds there. So we are trying to propose a different model, device model, basically monomial form. But then there is a problem that people who are dealing with device modeling, they are rather more interested of improving the accuracy of the model, but they are not bothered about the GP formulation. So then there is no guarantee of if you go for accurate model, what normally people use like BSIM model and other SPICE models, they don't give any guarantee of this monomial. So to survive ourselves, we have to develop our own model. We will be giving a guarantee of monomial dependency, but then at the same time, we have to improve the accuracy. So if you give this guarantee, then circuit performance, they will be polynomial in terms of this n variables. Okay, so that's what we are saying, that so far we are dealing with level one model. They support the geometric programming problem, but then they are having serious problem in submicron technology. On the other hand, if you look into say complex model like level three or BSIM models, they are accurate, but they will not be supporting geometric programming problem. So our objective is to develop a monomial MOS model, where what we do is that GM, GD, and ID, and capacitors we are expressing as monomial function in terms of width, length of the transistors. And also to improve the accuracy, not only we are keeping the monomial model, we are keeping the flexibility to improve the accuracy. So we are splitting into two factor of the model, first order model and second order model. First order model, we like to keep the monomial dependency. Second order part, we are keeping it separate. So as the technology progresses, the second order dependency might go big, more and more complex, but then there is no guarantee of monomial part. How do we deal with that? We'll see that. So basically, the end of the story is that GMGD, instead of having some power of ID 1 and W power 0.5 and so, we are calling these are some parameter. As long as this kind of functional form are maintained, then we do not have any problem of going into geometric programming problem. So what you are saying is that all these things, it should be in monomial form. Okay. But then if we are developing our own model, then it is our responsibility to find the value of this parameter. Nobody else will be providing, right? So then we have developed different techniques. Okay, apart from this one, first order model, we also have second order effects like variation of the threshold as, you know, body effect, and also a variation of transconductance parameter, and the variation of those parameter itself, this alpha, beta, all these things, they are also function of, you know, operating point. So all those things, they are captured through second order model. And the second order model, however, there is no restriction of this monomial form. Then you may say that, how do you, you know, ensuring the GP formulation? We'll see that. Anyway, I'll not be going detail of the how we find the parameter values of this model parameter, but just to give you a story that we develop some kind of small schematic to find the value of GD and things like that as function of their bias of the transistors. And this is what I like to say, that this is the GD as function of drain to source voltage. This we know, and this one is the simulated one, and this is simulated in SPICE, and it is a rather more accurate prediction. Now in this saturation region, we like to model this GD as monomial function of width, length, and other things, but also we can see that GD is function of drain to source voltage. So we are splitting this into two parts. One is called GD star, and GD star is defined value of GD here at the middle of the supply voltage, and this dependency, it will be captured by the second order term. So this is the normalized version of the GD, which is normalized with GD star. So we can see that at this point, this normalized GD is basically 1. And then this function we are arbitrarily selecting. Okay. When it's arbitrary, of course, we are having objective number of parameters should be as low as possible, but then we should not lose the accuracy. And we are fitting the parameter only here. So we have to give a key information that how do we separate the saturation region and the linear region. So in submicron, in long channel technology, this separation of the saturation region and linear region is basically VGS minus VTH. But in short channel device, due to mobility saturation, this knee point is getting shifted. So we cannot use this as the boundary point of saturation and linear. So we have defined the saturation region and linear region boundary. Basically, in the GD, we have drawn one asymptotic line here, another asymptotic line here, and the meeting point to here is basically defining the saturation region and linear region. Okay. So I should say, finally, we are getting the model of GD norm, which is arbitrary function. Of course, it is having different parameters, and there is no necessity of this should be monomial. That's what we are doing. But end of that, we have to reduce the number of parameters. It is already quite high, but then we have to ensure that accuracy is maintained. So one of them is simulated one, another is coming from this curve, and this is the accuracy level. So similarly for GD, similar to GD, we are doing also for the GM. GM we are splitting into first order model and then the second order model and things like that. Okay, so that is the story, but as I said, the accuracy level, it will be maintained. And not only GMGD, we are also modeling capacitors. And it is important to note that all these things is automated. So extracting all this data point and finding the value of these things, automated. That is because Suppose you have designed one circuit in 0.18 micron technology and it is working fine. And tomorrow your manager is coming saying that we have to port into 0.25 micron technology. Then once again you have to find all these parameters value, and then only you can make use of the GP formulation. So till now it was a bottleneck for us. So one person has written the script, and now what it is, his script, what it is doing is that in batch mode it runs the spice and it extracts the data file, and then he is having another MATLAB script, and MATLAB script it is generating those values of the parameter, and it takes overnight. So suppose you have a design, you would like to port same design into another technology, it will be a matter of overnight work, and then of course you run the GP formulation and it will take a minute. Okay, so this is the overall flow in presence of the second order terms. So far we are talking about this portion, but then we need to upgrade the design point, because this portion, it is here we are considering only the first order effect, and then this portion it is capturing the second order effect. And since we are trying to capture the second order effect, then there is no guarantee of the accuracy of the solution point. So we have to check the convergence of the iteration. It is basically it is an iterative method. So if it is not converging, we'll go back and then once again we'll upgrade the values of second order parameter in GM, GD, and so and so. So finally, we'll be getting the sized one. So this is the overall methodology. And we are having the device monomial, at least first order equations are monomial to support the GP formulation. Second order is, as I said, it is flexible. Yeah. So this is a circuit. I'm sure that if you are interested in microelectronics, particularly analog circuit, you will be coming across one of this important op-amp kind of things. I should say differential amplifier in integrated circuit. And you can see that a lot of transistors are there and resistors are there, and our methodology, it has been applied here, and to meet some of the specs like low frequency gain, slew rate, unity gain frequency, common mode range, and so and so. And while meeting the spec, also one of the objective is to find the active area as small as possible. One important thing is that this active area is also posinomial, while these constraints are also getting converted into posinomial. So tomorrow if you say that, no, I want to optimize gain rather than optimizing area, you can always interchange, because these constant functions, they are posinomial and this is also posinomial. So this is one way of formulating, saying that I am meeting the specs and I want to optimize the area. Or you can say that, no, I don't want to optimize this area, but as long as my area is less than this one, that is fine. So you can just swap any constraint here into this objective function, or you can say multiple functions you can take together, make a weighted sum, and then you can optimize that weighted sum meeting the other performance requirements. So basically, it is not that we should be always optimizing the area. You can optimize any of this parameter. Okay, so this is the specification for that circuit, folded cascode amplifier. This is the spec we have given, and end of the GP optimization problem, the predicted performances are like this one. So we can see that all the specs are met here. But then you say that whatever the values of W and L we got, is it really meaningful? So then what do you do with that, the value of W and L? We have run this spice and we have observed the what will be the circuit performance. So instead of 50 dB gain, we got 45 dB gain, and instead of unity gain frequency, say 510 megahertz, we got 440 megahertz. And so you can see the discrepancy is still there, but I, based on my knowledge, it goes, we can still call this is not a bad accuracy. I should say rather it is a good match. So if you cannot tolerate this much, what you can do is that while you are defining the spec, that time itself you put a margin here, and instead of 50 you can say 55. Okay, and to get this if you change the spec and to get the size, it is a matter of 1 minute job running the code, that's all. So if you are doing this design in say 0.18 micron technology targeting to this one, this is fine. And then as I said, you are let me look into the circuit performance also. This is the Bode plot obtained from SPICE. And then you say that instead of 0.18 micron technology, I want to design the same circuit in this technology. Okay, and maybe you have changed the spec. So of course, as I said, overnight job, you have to get the model parameter value, and then after that it is 1 minute job to get the size. And once again, sorry, this will be a 3 dB error. So once again, if you end of this one, if you see the SPICE predicted performance and GP predicted performance, they are pretty close. So once again, the circuit performance is like this, and that's all. Okay. Is it? I think I am in time. I am having another 7-8 minutes. But in case if you have any queries, please let me know. So.